I feel very honored that I'm allowed to give the final presentation of this inspiring conference. So, and I also want to thank the co-organizers for this conference, especially because my slides will be mainly a ventilation of my frustrations over the years I've been doing RTL development, and so I can relieve myself of these things and then move on from there, probably. So, and so I want to say, yeah, this is a everything I say is in my humble opinion only, and I like to be proven wrong. I can put things forward, I think, in an opinionated way, but it's to have discussion on it and not to say that I know everything. So how it all started for me was actually, I don't know, people know about Bitcoin, likely. So in 2013, there was a time where you could still mine Bitcoins on an FPGA. I was just a simple SROM designer, and I said to my dad some nice FPGA dev boards, let me take one home, I want to learn RTL programming. And actually, I wanted to take it home to do mining at home on this FPGA. So when I started doing things, and I ported some Bitcoin mining code on the FPGA. And I can say at that time it was a frustrating experience at best. So yeah, you think you have an integrated development environment that if you compile something and it doesn't give an error that it should run. So that's not the case with an FPGA I discovered. So sometimes it runs, sometimes it didn't run, and I could not find out. Likely it was later on I discovered it was likely cross clock domain or timing problems, but yeah, at that time. But I still, and then I thought, yeah, maybe I have to have some persistence to really know this better. So probably it's just me, I'm coming from a software background that I have bad expectations, but I still feel that the tools are not good enough yet. So, and let me say, so, and also I call my company Chip for Makers, so I want to make it maker friendly. What I see as a maker is a jack of all trades, master of none. It means that he does a lot of things. He does what he needs to do to get what his idea done. He can do mechanical design, PCB design, FPGA design, and ASIC design, maybe even some chemistry. And then when he has done something else and he comes back, he should be able to easily get back into it. And I don't have the feeling that we can do that with FedOrg and VHDL. If you have not done it for a year, it's very difficult to get back into it. So let me summarize the main problems I have with these RTL programs, programming languages. I only have 20 minutes, so I have to really have to summarize this. So one of my main things is that in both in FedOrg and VHDL, a clock signal is a digital signal like any other signal. It just happened to have that you look at the rising and falling edge. And to me that is wrong, because a clock is a very different signal than all the other signals in your, and it should have a separate data type at least. And then, so then you also need to know what is inferred. So when I talk to the front-end guys, so the RTL developers were called the front-end guys in IMEC, you write an if statement, but you talk about a MUX, or you talk about an asynchronous reset, or you talk about a flip-flop, and you don't talk at the same level about what you write than what you're writing. So it's the same thing as writing C code, but discussing about jumps or instructions to me. Yeah. I'm coming from a software background, so people who are doing RTL their whole life, they have probably a totally different vision on this. Also, what to me is very difficult to is the distinction between synthesizable and non-synthesizable RTL code. That's, you have a language that is made to make hardware, but some of that, it's same that the C++ comes up with a feature that you cannot compile in a program or so. That seems not logical to me. Also, and I think this is a Verilog thing, is blocking versus non-blocking statement. Is you have a language that actually describes hardware, so everything is parallel, but in one way or another, some of the signals can still be serial next to each other, which seems to be kind of, and that's generating a lot of problems. And I think that is really, a lot of time has been lost, I think, on this blocking versus non-blocking statements. And also, that's one of the reasons why I prefer VHDL over Verilog, but okay, that's another discussion. Also, when your language does not handle all the features, you add some extra files on top of it to be able to do what you want. You have then tickle timing constraints, you have the common power platform, power format or the unified format to handle multi-clock domains, power domains. And then often you have, like here, different standards to do the same thing. Also, when you have something working on FPGA, it does not mean that it will work on an ASIC. At IMEC, they have a lot of experience of that, is that people who have something that is on an FPGA, and then they say, yeah, we need weeks or months to get it on an ASIC. I say, why? It works on my FPGA. And then I think that has been a lot of less the last is that is read the language reference manual is that when I started in 2013, you could go online and then, yeah, at this page in the language standard, you can say it's like that. And to me, when you have to refer to language manual and you cannot just explain why you do things, then you're not in a good way. And it also means that some people who want to brag about how good they know the language reference manual. But I have to say, I don't see that often anymore. I think this has already been solved by going open source, all the things. So you have then the Verilog and the VHDL standards, and they have been evolving over the time. System Verilog 2008, I think I recently saw that they have even a more recent VHDL standard, 2018-19 or so, now released. They have added a lot of things, but to me, I don't think they fixed the fundamental problems. For me, it's more lipstick on a pig than really solving the problems. Again, all in my humble opinion, of course. Then you also have, one of the problems I also see is pipelining. You have then this TL Verilog where you can do pipelining, but it's still a fixed pipelining. So also here, I don't think it fixes the fundamental problem. Then you also have the system C and the, transaction level or transaction, yeah, something with transaction. Eh? Transaction level modeling, yeah, that was the yeah, it's on the slide. So there you can describe things in C++, but again, I think they assume here that you have a clock and a rising edge and a falling edge of a clock. And what I've seen is that it's mainly used for simulation or verification, but it's not really used to generate for synthesize. I think they also have been working on a synthesizable part of system C, but I've never seen a guy who really synthesizes system C. So that's what I'm trying to explain here, is that you have then the system C for, I think Vivavo HLS allows you to also use system C to do synthesis. I think for high-level synthesis or electronic system level design, you have now mostly the priority tools, the FPGA tools, Vivavo, HLS, Catapult. I don't know if you are aware, there are a few open source ones who do also try to do this, which is the Panda Bamboo and the Gout, but they are not very actively developed. I think it would be nice for specific application to have something like that. But I don't think it will ever be able, because sometimes they sell these things, yeah, it's to let programmers also make hardware, is to have the high level. system languages, but to me, this is too far away from the hardware. So if you let a programmer use that, he will never make efficient hardware. So it's too much away. The implication of a stack when you do a function call and all these things is too far away, and you will never make efficient hardware if you do it this way, or let the programmer do it this way. So you really have to, again, think about it. So then you have MyHDL, which is an implementation that have been done before, but it's based on RTL type thing. Also here, it's mainly a Python implementation of Verilog and VHDL. So also, I think it's the same problems. Also, I have to apologize. I don't look at everything, all the languages that come up. So, for example, there has been Clash in this slide. And it's just that I don't always feel triggered when I see a presentation about them. So I may miss some pearls. So let me give you then what I think are some of the things that are going to the right direction is you have then Chisel and Spanel AGL. They have been presented here at the conference before. I think they are doing really the abstraction of the clock and the reset in a proper way, and you can use it as a building. What for me is the problem is that they're both based on Scala, so I'm too old to learn a new language. But for young people, it's probably not a problem. So my preference at the moment is MeGen and MeGen, which has similar things. And it also has a proper abstraction of clock and reset. But to me, I think this is only the start. If you see in the software community, you have the same discussions in the 90s about what is best assembly or high-level languages. And then you went the high-level languages route. And then if you see all the innovation that happened on top of it, C++, Java, scripting, Scheme, Perl, Python, all these things. This still has to happen in the open source hardware world. And I was lying in the beginning that it's just putting forward my frustration. It's also that I think we can now, when we clean up the base work, then we can really start innovating. And also, I don't think there can be too many languages. We have to try a lot of things and then find out what works best to make hardware. And I was contacted by a guy who was then working on pipelining, so that you would have a data path description and that the pipelining would be done automatically by your compiler and that you don't have to do it manually and that you have to reshuffle things when you want to go from 3 to 4 stages in your pipeline of things. And these are the things that I think have to happen next. I have my own ideas how to do it in NMeGen, but of course I have too many ideas and not enough time. And I will skip this one because I think I'm close to my time. But yeah, okay. I want to thank you and hopefully some discussion.
Thanks, and I largely agree with the list of complaints. I do want to ask you about your complaint with the synthesizable versus non-synthesizable subset concept. That's there to do things in, say, Verilog, like print to the console, things that couldn't possibly end up in the hardware. Presumably, any such general-purpose software-based library would have these things available as well. And it would not necessarily be clear which things could synthesize into hardware and which could not. And many would be properties of how well implemented they are by the library, such as MeGen or Chisel. So what did you mean by that? Is that a call for kind of a more clear delineation of what synthesizes and doesn't? Or maybe could you expand on where you find the frustration there?
Yeah. I think I can agree that for the pure debugging things, like giving feedback to, you can have some non-synthesizable part. To me, it's the whole verification part, which is has their own classes, own functions. That is not this, but more really verification that you can write test bunches that do the verification, but are not synthesizable. It's that part, but you really do computation and manipulation of things, and that are not synthesizable. So pure debugging, I can agree that you can have in code. You also have things that are in a debug statement that are not compiled in your final program. So I think I can compromise on that. But having this whole infrastructure for verification that is not synthesizable, that's a mismatch. I mean, that should not be there, in my opinion. But I can discuss about use cases that you think that should not be synthesizable. Because I think if you go higher level in your tool chain that compilers can do this data pot, they should be able to handle what is now non-synthesizable.
Yeah, it just seems that to use a general purpose programming language is kind of going in the opposite direction, right? It's essentially almost everything is not synthesizable. A very small subset will be. So maybe that line gets even blurrier is the net result.
Yeah.
Staff, thank you for your talk, and you raised a lot of common things. I've heard one or two talks from various people who've come from the same background as you and me, which are software engineers who have started to engage with hardware. You get the same themes come up and down. I think I take a slightly different view on the synthesis versus simulation. I think that is a problem with the way the languages were conceived. There are two problems they're trying to solve. One is the simulation problem, the other is the synthesis problem. I think what you're describing is an ideal synthesis HDL for describing something to wait. And I think that's the right approach to go. Leave the simulation to some other tool. Some of the problems you raise, I think, can be dealt are just syntactic sugar in the languages. Non-blocking assignments versus blocking assignments. Most tools will warn you if you try and use a blocking assignment in sequential logic, and won't even allow you to use a non-blocking assignment in combinatorial logic. So some of those things are easy to be solved. But when you get to the bottom of it, software programming language is about taking problems that are fundamentally parallel, have parallelism in them, and making them as sequential as possible. And standard HDLs are about taking problems that have some parallelism and making them as parallel as possible. And it's not always helpful to look at sequential programming languages as your starting point. And you're better starting by looking at your detailed model of parallelism. And if you've ever tried to co-simulate System C and Verilog or VHDL and Verilog, which have slightly different semantic models at the edge of how timing behaves, you get horrible bugs. And I suggest is start with working out what your model of parallelism is and how it maps down to real hardware, and then build the language around that. Because unless you get that right, you will end up with something that doesn't really work.
Yeah, it's a lot of, you said a lot of things, eh? So I will probably forget to handle some of the things, but I think it's my opinion, I'm coming from a software ground, you should try to serialize the things as much as possible and keep close to the hardware, because I think a human brain is better fit for thinking sequentially than thinking in parallel. A human brain does not think parallel. You focus on one thing and you see what is going on, and you don't see more than one thing at the same time in your brain. And if you try to have this parallel thing, then you need a lot of tools to do that, and then you will make mistakes that you have to be able to correct. So that's one of my opinions on that. And some things you will need to go to the parallel level. But I see that the same thing as for embedded programming, sometimes you need to go to assembly language to have interrupts, all the things. But I think there can be so many things that you have to do on top that can be much bigger, but these things still have to happen. But I don't think in 10 or 20 years that will be the majority of what we will be doing for making hardware. But that's certainly my opinion.